Thank you very much. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. We begin with Allah's blessed name. We praise Him and we glorify Him as He ought to be praised and glorified. And we pray for peace and for blessings on all His noble messengers, and in particular on the last of them all, the Blessed Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Sister Chairman, brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I hope you'll excuse me. I had an attack of a virus some 3 weeks ago, and I'm still suffering from a cough. And the doctor recommended warm water. So if you'll allow me to keep sipping, inshallah, while I speak. Our topic is not the gold dinar and the future of money. Our topic is the gold dinar, Islam, and the future of money. And hence, it would be necessary for me to take you to the Quran and take you to Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. But that's a strange journey, because the modern world does not recognize any link between religion and politics, between religion and economics, and particularly between religion and international monetary economics. And so we have to paint a strange and unusual canvas today. It is not something to which you are normally accustomed, nor are there many scholars of Islam today who ever attempt to paint such a canvas. Let me begin by laying a foundation from the Quran for what is to be presented later in the topic. Allah speaks in Surah Al-Ma'idah of the Quran, Surah number 5, and the verse is verse number 49, somewhere around there. And He says, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا. O you who have faith in Allah. لا تتخذوا اليهود والنصارى أولياء. Do not. This is a command from Him who created us from a drop of sperm. Do not take Jews and Christians as your friends and allies. Is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaking about all Jews and all Christians? Or is He speaking about some Jews and some Christians? The Quran answers that question. There are many verses of the Quran which permit us to establish fraternal relations with Jews and Christians. A Muslim man can even marry a Christian woman, other than in Malaysia, of course. A Muslim man can marry a Christian woman. Yes, the Quran permits that. And so, very clearly, this verse of the Quran is speaking about some Jews and some Christians, and not all Jews and all Christians. Well then, which Jews and which Christians are those with whom it is prohibited for us to maintain friendly ties, to establish alliance, to be allies? The verse goes on to answer that question. لا تتخذوا اليهود والنصارى أولياء. بعضهم أولياء بعض. Which means, and please listen carefully, do not take such Jews and such Christians as your friends and allies who themselves are friends and allies of each other. وَمَنْ يَتَوَلَّهُمْ مِنْكُمْ The Lord of the heavens and the earth is speaking. Whosoever amongst you, whether you be a carpenter or a taxi driver or a datu or a tun or a tunku, it doesn't matter. Whosoever amongst you establishes friendly relations or alliance with such Jews and Christians will no longer be part of the Muslim world. You've now joined them. You're part of them, not us. And when you die, when the angel comes to take your soul, at that time you will have it confirmed. You're not a Muslim. You're not a Muslim. وَمَنْ يَتَوَلَّهُمْ مِنْكُمْ فَإِنَّهُ مِنْهُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِي الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ Surely Allah will never, 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 never provide guidance for a people who commit such an atrocious act of evil and of wrongdoing. Oh, but wait a minute. Jews and Christians were never friends of each other. Never in history. In fact, the Christians accused the Jews of having committed the ultimate crime, namely, killing God himself. That's the ultimate crime, to kill God himself. They crucified the Lord. And as a consequence, there was always animosity and hatred and hostility between Christians and Jews. And so this verse of the Quran, revealed 1400 years ago in the desert of Arabia, this verse of the Quran anticipates a day that would come in history when there would be a strange and baffling and puzzling and mysterious and mystifying rapprochement between Christians and Jews and the establishment of friendly ties and a Christian-Jewish alliance will emerge. 1400 years ago, Allah is saying that this will happen. And when it happens, you better be careful. Because if you allow yourself to maintain friendly ties with them, your Islam is gone. Has that alliance come into being as yet? Yes. While we were drinking tea tariq and chatting, a mysterious Judeo-Christian alliance emerged in Europe. While we were studying our economics and politics at university, a mysterious Judeo-Christian, Jewish-Christian alliance emerged. And it is that Jewish-Christian alliance which delivered to the world modern Western civilization. It is that Jewish-Christian alliance which today rules the world and dominates the world. It is that Christian-Jewish alliance which gave to the world the United Nations Organization. It is that Jewish-Christian alliance which gave to the world Bretton Woods and the International Monetary Fund and today's so-called International Monetary System. And if you join them, if you become a part of them, if you allow yourselves to become subservient to them, if you establish friendly ties with them and become part of that alliance, part of that system, you've lost your Islam. That's not an easy bite to swallow and digest. Not at all. And this is perhaps the first time any of you is being introduced to this verse of the Quran this way. Without a doubt, this is the first time. And hence you can see that the verse, the subject, the golden hour, Islam and the future of money, has a perspective from the Quran and from the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, which is absolutely unique even to your muftis, who are blissfully ignorant of the subject. My language is harsh, but I can be harsh because I'm 65 years of age. And if you send me to Guantanamo, how long will I last? Bilal, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the companion of the Prophet, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, came to the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, and offered him some dates. The Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, looked at the dates. He said, Bilal, these are very fine dates. Where did you get them? Bilal said, O Messenger of Allah, I had two baskets, two sa'as, of inferior quality dates. And I exchanged them for this one basket of superior quality dates. The value of the two was equivalent to the value of the one. So it was a fair exchange. I exchanged these two baskets of inferior quality dates for this one basket of superior quality dates. Here you are, Messenger of Allah, have some dates. Bilal, said the Prophet, this is the essence of riba. Oh my gosh, he must be perspiring, because you know riba. If you consume even one dirham of riba, it is equivalent to committing zina 36 times, said the Messenger of Allah. Dirham? What's that? Dirham. That's money, eh? Silver coin. Worth a few ringgits. And in the very last revelation which came down in the Quran, the very last revelation on the authority of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu and recorded in the Sahih of Imam Bukhari. The very last revelation is one in which Allah addressed those who lend money on interest, like banks, and said, give it up. Stop. And if you don't, then I and my messenger are going to wage war on you. So this is not something easy. Bilal, this is the essence of riba. What you should have done was to sell the two baskets as a separate transaction, and then take that money and buy this one basket as a separate transaction. Two separate transactions. But a direct exchange of two baskets of dates for one was haram, was riba. But Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu exchanged four camels for one. Yeah. And that was not haram. That was not riba. And Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu exchanged 20 camels for one. The 20 may have been babies. And that was not haram, and that was not riba. 100 years ago, if we had asked the question, why is it that it was permissible to exchange, unequal exchange of animals? That's okay. But an unequal exchange of dates was haram and riba. 100 years ago, even a school child would have been able to answer that question. Today, and I know, because I travel around the world, and I lecture, and I ask this question in a Darul Ulum, with the professor sitting, and the senior students in front of me, and about 700 students, nobody could answer it. That's a Darul Ulum. What about bank? Development bank? The answer is, the answer is located in another hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, to which I shall now introduce you. He said, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wasallam, if a transaction involves the exchange of gold for gold, or silver for silver, or wheat for wheat, or barley for barley, or dates for dates, or salt for salt, so long as it is like for like, it must be equal for equal. If you have two baskets of dates on this side, you must have two on that side. Then the exchange would be halal. If not, if you have an unequal exchange of gold for gold, or an unequal exchange of silver for silver, or any one of the others, it would be riba. Why? It would be haram. Why? And why four camels for one? Okay, bully. 20 camels for one? Okay. But this one, tabuli. The answer is that there is something in common in all six. What is it that is common to all six? Answer, all of these were used as money. Used as money in the form of a medium of exchange. I need a haircut. And I asked my wife, I don't have time, can you cut? She says, no, go to the barber. Sometimes your wife tells you that, doesn't she? So I go to the barber. And he cuts my hair. When he's finished cutting my hair, I've got to pay him. So I offer him a copy of my book, Jerusalem in the Quran. He says, Sheikh, I'm sorry, I'm not interested in your book. Barter has its limitations. Huh? I need money. I need to pay him for the haircut with money. And he can use that money, go in the market, buy durian. So, medium of exchange. How much should I pay for the haircut? And how much should he pay for the durian? The value of the haircut and the value of the durian. Money becomes a measure of value. And thirdly, after I pay him for the haircut, he wants to take that money and keep it. Store it for some time. But he doesn't want money that leaks. You get a leak and all the money leak out. No. He wants something that can store the money, like a bank vault can store it. So money must also function as a store, a value. So the amount of time he took to cut my hair would not be wasted, would not be lost. All six of these functioned as money. Two of these are precious metals, gold and silver. And four are, if you have a better term to describe these, please help me. I've been using the word commodity. If you have a better word, tell me. So I say four of these, because these are also commodities. Four of these are commodities, and two of these are precious metals. So when there was a shortage of gold and silver, dinar and dirham, in the market in Medina, they would use dates as money. What was common to all of these four is that they were all in plentiful supply in the market. And number two, they had what may be called a shelf life. Not like mangoes. Your money is rotting. No. You want money which can last for some time. So here we are. I have just introduced you to money in Islam. Precious metals or commodities. But commodities which are in plentiful supply and which have a shelf life. So if you have a shortage of gold and silver in Indonesia, what would you use as money? Not you, Nick Mahoney, somebody else. What would you use as money in Java? Java? Rice? Would you use rice as money? Yeah, rice is in plentiful supply, okay, and the rice can be stored for some time. Or what about the island of Cuba? And you do not want to support tobacco smoking, because even Fidel Castro has stopped smoking now, Fidel Castro has stopped smoking. So you're in the island of Cuba. Let's test your geography for a while. You're in the island of Cuba, my neighbor in the Caribbean, and you want to have money. You do not have enough gold and silver in the market. What would you use as money in Cuba? Sugar is correct. Okay? The second thing that is common to all six that Dr. Mahathir did not agree with 15 years ago, but today, Allah be praised, Dr. Mahathir has now understood. The second thing that is common to all six is that the value of the money is inside the money, regardless of what that value may be. Regardless of whether that value may fluctuate, The fact is that the value of the money is inside the money. And this is called intrinsic value. 15 years ago, I was here in Malaysia. And I heard Dr. Mahathir with my own ears, not somebody else's ears. And he said, money has no intrinsic value. I have lived to see the day when he's made a U-turn. I have now introduced you to money in your religion of Islam. Money in Islam is either precious metals or commodities, which have a shelf life and which are in plentiful supply. And secondly, money in Islam is money which has intrinsic value. Because dates were used as money, you had to have an equal exchange. Two baskets for two baskets. If you allowed an exchange of one basket for two, what would you do? Although the value may be the same, by permitting an unequal exchange of money, the same money, one basket for two, you are opening the door for money to be lent on interest. I give you 1,000 and you return 2,000. And over a period of time. So in order to close the door for money being lent on interest, Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam said this. Now who can answer the question? Well, why was it permissible to exchange four camels for one? Because animals were never used as money. I work for a whole month and I get my salary. My salary is a goat. So I'm taking the goat home. But this fellow came with his Mercedes-Benz motor car and he knocked down my goat and the goat died. So I went home and I told my wife, salary died. So she said, go tell the boss, salary died. So I went to the boss, I said, boss, salary died. Boss said, well, when I gave you salary, salary was alive. Because animals can die. Because animals can fall ill. Animals cannot function as money. This is the answer that any school child could have given 100 years ago. And almost no one can answer today. If this is money in Islam, how then can we explain a world today in which money with intrinsic value has disappeared? How can we explain? To answer that question, I'm going to now have to paint the bigger canvas to show the linkages between economics and politics, between international monetary economics and international politics and riba and the Quran and the Bible. It's a very interesting canvas. Very few scholars of Islam today attempt to study the subject. Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam confirmed what is also in the Quran, that Allah had made a promise to Banu Israel, the Israelite people, that he would send to them a prophet who would be their prophet and who would be known as the Messiah. Al-Masih. And when the Messiah comes, he'd bring back the golden age. when Nabi Sulaiman alayhi salam ruled the world from the state of Israel, the holy state of Israel in Jerusalem. And the Jews therefore rule the world. That golden age will come back when the Messiah comes. This entire subject is explained in my book at the back there, Jerusalem, in the Quran. When Allah sent the Messiah, however, He sent the Messiah in a way to test them. And they failed the test. They said, when she came with the baby, but she was not married, they said, this is a bastard. وَقَوْلِهِمْ وَبِكُفْرِهِمْ وَقَوْلِهِمْ عَلَى مَرْيَمَ بُهْطَانًا عَظِيمًا. They hurl this monstrous slur on the fair name of Mary. No, she gave birth to the baby, but she was sinless. It was what the Catholics call an immaculate conception. When the baby grew up and declared, I am the Messiah, they said, no, a bastard cannot be the Messiah. So they rejected him. And then when he started to condemn them for their evil, and in particular lending money on interest, they decided that he must die. And they held a kangaroo court and then forced the hand of the Roman government. And then when they saw him die on the cross, before their very eyes, they saw it. They said, that confirms he could not have been the Messiah. Why? Because the Messiah has to rule the world from the holy state of Israel, from Jerusalem, and bring back the golden age. But he is dead. So he could not have been the Messiah. 600 years later, Allah waited 600 years. 600 years later, Allah sent down the Quran. And 600 years later, mankind learned for the first time. وَمَا قَتَلُوهُ. No. They did not succeed in killing him. وَمَا صَلَبُوهُ. No. They did not succeed in crucifying him. This is your book speaking. وَلَكِنْ شُبِّهَ لَهُمْ. Allah made it appear like that. بَلْ رَفَعُهُ اللَّهُ إِلَيْهِ. Allah raised him. He did not experience something called maut. What is maut? Maut is when Allah takes the soul and does not send it back. Last night, He took some of your souls. Some of you right here. But He sent it back. That's why you're here this morning. Yeah. Surah Az-Zumar. But if He takes the soul and does not send it back, that is maut. That never happened in the case of Nabi Isa alayhi salam. One day He's coming back. When He comes back, He's going to rule the world from the holy state of Israel. Rule the world from Jerusalem. And history will end. That will be the end of history. With the final and conclusive victory of truth over falsehood. The religion of Abraham, alayhi salam, will prevail over all rivals. But they didn't know that. They thought He died. He could not have been the Messiah. And so they're waiting for the Messiah to come. Allah's messenger explained that Allah created a being and programmed that being to impersonate the Messiah. And so he is known as Al-Masih al-Dajjal, Dajjal, the false Messiah of the Antichrist. And he is going to rule the world from an imposter state of Israel, not the true state of Israel, an imposter state of Israel. And he's going to rule the world from Jerusalem. And he's going to declare, I am the Messiah. And they will all be deceived and accept him as the Messiah. By my calculation, children now at school would live to see that. And I've been studying the subject for 15, 20 years now. How is he going to rule the world? He can only rule the world if he can impose a universal political dictatorship over mankind. And he can only rule the world if he can impose a universal economic dictatorship over mankind. And he can only rule the world if he can impose a universal financial dictatorship over mankind. If you do not have eyes to see that dictatorship around the corner, then you are sleeping. Because the world has advanced far down that road already towards the emergence of a universal political dictatorship, a universal economic dictatorship, a universal financial dictatorship over all of mankind, so that from that imposter state of Israel, you can have a ruling state ruling the whole world. My book, Jerusalem in the Quran, uses the ahadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam to follow the stages through which this will emerge. Three stages. In each stage, a ruling state. And that ruling state takes control of money. Now we see the link between religion, the scriptures, and money, and monetary economics. That first stage already came and went when Britain was the ruling state in the world. And the Bank of England was created somewhere around 1796. And the process emerged of trying to modify and corrupt money. Britain became the ruling state in the world, and Britain established a mysterious relationship with the Holy Land. 1917, for example, the Balfour Declaration. The British government declares it is the intention of the British government to work for the establishment of a Jewish national home in the Holy Land. Yeah, 1917. And then Britain presided over the birth of the imposter state of Israel in 1948. And then came a second stage, also from the Hadith, in which a second ruling state emerged, the United States of America. And when the United States of America emerged as a ruling state, the sterling pound was no longer the international currency. The sterling pound had to give way to a new money, the US dollar. And the Bank of England had to give way to a new monetary system from Bretton Woods, the International Monetary Fund. And now that second stage is drawing to a close. And a third and last stage in the historical process is around the corner. The United States is not going to remain the ruling state in the world for long again. I think many of you will agree with that. A third and a last ruling state is going to emerge. Who am I to say a third and a last ruling state will emerge? What authority do I have to say what no other scholar of international relations says anywhere else in the world? I say it because I'm a Muslim. Because I get guidance from that man, Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. They don't teach that in the Fletcher School of Diplomacy. No. They don't teach that at the Graduate Institute of International Studies in Geneva, Switzerland, where I was myself a doctoral student. A third and a last stage will witness the emergence of a third and a last ruling state. That is around the corner. If Iran is attacked, for example, which is possible. If nuclear weapons are used, for example, which is possible. You see the price of oil skyrocketing. You see the price of gold skyrocketing. But as bankers, you would know, it's not the price of oil going up, you dum-dum. It's not the price of gold going up, you dum-dum. It's the U.S. dollar falling. Bankers would know that. Not just falling, it's the U.S. dollar collapsing. Not just collapsing, but as Judy Shelton wrote in her book, Money Meltdown, she published that book about 6-7 years ago. She said it's going to be a money meltdown. An important scholar in international monetary economics, Judy Shelton, prophesying a money meltdown. When that money meltdown takes place, the U.S. dollar collapses, this entire fraudulent, what's the word for fraudulent again? Penny Puan. This Penny Puan Kabir. This big Penny Puan. This entire fraudulent international monetary system will collapse. I expect that as the U.S. dollar collapses, there's going to be a stampede away from paper money. You may want to think about that. And of course, when I make these, give these opinions of mine, remember only Allah does not make mistakes. Eh? There's going to be a stampede away from paper money. People are going to be dumping their paper quickly so they don't have to use it as wallpaper. And that would facilitate the replacement of this international monetary system with a new one that you bankers are already familiar with, namely electronic money. If paper money was fraudulent, Penny Puan Kabir, then electronic money is Penny Puan even more Kabir. As the United States declines, the economy collapses, and electronic money takes over, the state of Israel will then replace the United States as the ruling state in the world. That's coming. You remember me when it happens. And when Israel becomes a new ruling state in the world, the Judeo-Christian alliance, which brought modern Western civilization into being, the Judeo-Christian alliance, which gave us the United Nations organization and the permanent members with their veto powers, and the United States casting the veto again and again and again and again to protect Israel. The United Nations organization will be redundant. They don't need it anymore. They've already used it for what they wanted. The International Monetary Fund has already been used for what they needed it for. No more paper money. They don't need that anymore. And so a new world is coming. It is such a frightful world that one mind cannot understand it. I need your help. We have to bring a number of minds together to understand what's going to happen when paper money collapses. It is like a financial Armageddon. That's around the corner. While, of course, we scholars of Islam drinking tea tariq. It would be helpful If we would take a step back and examine this process, study it from my book, Jerusalem in the Quran. When Israel becomes the ruling state in the world, then eventually a man will emerge as the ruler of Israel. He will be born of Jewish parents, said the Prophet ﷺ. He would be a young man, powerfully built, with curly hair. And ruling the world from Jerusalem, he's going to declare, I am the Messiah. No, he would not be the Messiah. He would be the false Messiah. He would be Dajjal. That's coming. He is the mastermind. He is the mastermind behind the emergence of this mysterious alliance in Europe, this Jewish-Christian alliance. He is the mastermind behind the institutions which we have created, political dictatorship, the United Nations Organization, economic dictatorship, the World Bank, financial dictatorship, the IMF. And so we go back to Bretton Woods. And we take the Bretton Woods Treaty and we read it, as most people have not read it. Even most bankers have not read it, the Bretton Woods Agreement. And we go to the Articles of Agreement of the IMF and we study it, as most people have not, even bankers have not studied it. When we go to the Bretton Woods Agreement, we see that they decided no more redeemability for paper money. Redeem means you can take your paper money to a bank and get the gold. That's redeeming the paper. The US dollar was like that. Is it 1 hour as yet? $20 for one ounce of gold. Up to 1933, anybody could go to a bank in the United States with 20 US dollars in currency notes and redeem it for 1 ounce of gold. But at Bretton Woods, they decided no more. No more. All the paper money were in the world, all of them, no more redeemability to gold. So the integrity of money is gone. But you needed a fig leaf to cover your nakedness. So they decided one currency would have the fig leaf, the US dollar. That will give to the US dollar some respectability. And when the US dollar declares, that it declares, in God we trust, you saw it? It's because the US dollar is the only paper money in the world which is redeemable in gold. Not your ringgit and not their rupiah. And Bretton Woods declared that the redeemability would be at $35 an ounce of gold. But Bretton Woods declared that not Tom, Dick, and Harry. No, you can't go to Uncle Sam and say, here's my $35, give me the ounce of gold. Only central banks. Only central banks. So what, central banks are the only people going to be using this money? No. All of mankind are using this money. And so, number one, to destroy the redeemability to gold meant destroying the integrity of money. And number two, declaring that only central banks can redeem the US dollar, nobody else, meant that this money had only 0.1% integrity. It was totally fraudulent. Well, then where were the scholars of Islam? Where were the muftis in the 1940s? Where were they? Could they not see? If you're not allowed to speak, like my freedom to speak, I don't think will last for long again. And my freedom to travel, I don't think would last for long again. But if I don't have the freedom to speak, and if I don't have the freedom to travel, can't I at least write? Can't I publish something? So today, in the year 2007, I could pick up this paper written by a scholar of Islam in 1945, in which he analyzes the Bretton Woods Accord and declares that this is an international monetary system that is utterly fraudulent. Where do we have that document today? From Bretton Woods, from Bretton Woods, therefore, emerged this international monetary system. The US dollar is pegged to gold. It is redeemable at $35 an ounce. But all the rest of the paper money in the world are now pegged to the US dollar. So when we ask, what is the value of the Malaysian ringgit? You have to answer and say, 340. 340 means what? 340 means 340 in exchanging to the US dollar. If you give the value of the Malaysian ringgit in terms of gold, they will ask you, where did you come from, Mars or Venus? So now all the paper money in the world are linked to the US dollar. And the US dollar is the only currency in the world redeemable in gold. The United States is a ruling state in the world, and it has as its mission to protect the state of Israel until Israel grows with massive economic help, massive financial help, massive transfer of military technology, until Israel becomes a superpower, until Israel can attack any state in Europe today. While the United States has the control over money. This is the ummah of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam we're talking about. And then they established the International Monetary Fund. And when you study the articles of agreement of the International Monetary Fund, you see something strange. You see something strange. Prohibiting money to be linked with gold. You can link your money to rambutan, no problem. You can link your money to durian, no problem. You can link your money to anything that they sell in Pasar Malam, no problem. But you cannot link your money to gold. No, gold cannot be used as legal tender. Go ask your government of Malaysia today. Go and ask them. Why is gold not allowed as legal tender? They cannot answer that question. None of them. No, they can't. Why? Because the IMF cannot answer that question. The Federal Reserve Bank of the United States cannot answer that question. Why have you prohibited the link between money and gold? Here is a letter written by Congressman Ron Paul, who is a candidate for the present presidential elections in the United States. Regarding Article 4, Section 2B of the International Monetary Fund's Articles of Agreement. As you may be aware, this language prohibits countries who are members of the IMF from linking their currency to gold. Thus, the IMF is forbidding countries suffering from an erratic monetary policy from adopting the most effective means of stabilizing their currency. This policy could delay a country's recovery from an economic crisis and retard economic growth, thus furthering economic and political instability. I would greatly appreciate an explanation from both the Treasury and the Federal Reserve of the reasons the United States has continued to acquiesce in this misguided policy. Please contact Mr. Norman Singleton, my legislative director, if you require any further information regarding this request. Thank you for your cooperation in this matter. Ron Paul, United States House of Representatives. Ron Paul has been waiting 5 years for a reply. They will not answer. Why? Because the Bretton Woods Agreement and the International Monetary Fund, which emerged out of it, was designed to impose a financial dictatorship upon mankind. It is more than simply ripping off people, more than simply making Indonesia a poor country. It is actually financial dictatorship. When you have paper money with no intrinsic value, then you can modify and manipulate the value of the paper. Something called, I don't know if you've heard the term, devaluation. Familiar with that? Devaluation. The Quran in 3 places has prohibited diminishing the value of people's wealth, property, services, goods. Allah says, وَلَا تَبْخَسُ النَّاسَ أَشْيَاءَهُمْ. Do not diminish, make little, the value of people's property, wealth, etc. وَلَا تَبْخَسُ النَّاسَ أَشْيَاءَهُمْ. Okay. In April 1933, President Roosevelt of the United States, the Federal Reserve Bank has just been established in the United States, and it is a private institution, not a public institution. And in April of 1933, the U.S. government enacts legislation prohibiting Americans, residents, from keeping gold, gold money, gold coins, gold bullion. You can keep your jewelry. So gold is demonetized. Gold is no longer allowed as legal tender. If you're caught with gold after a certain date, then we're going to put you in jail for 6 months and fine you $10,000. So the American people rushed to exchange their gold for U.S. dollars at 20 U.S. dollars for 1 ounce of gold. Those who had some idea of the scam that was coming, the smart ones, like the ones who didn't go to work on 9/11, no? What they did was, they took all the paper money they could get and bought gold the other way around. And then they shipped the gold to Switzerland. It's out of Uncle Sam's reach. After all the American people had exchanged their U.S. their gold for U.S. dollars, then in January of 1934, President Roosevelt removed the law, rescinded the law, remonetized gold. You are allowed now to keep your gold. However, we have devalued the dollar. The dollar is no longer 20 for 1 ounce. It is now devalued to to $35 for 1 ounce. He should have been sent to jail for 35 years for what he's done now. So the American people rush back to buy back their gold. When they bought back their gold, they got only this much. And Uncle Sam kept 41% in his pocket. Because the value of the paper had been devalued. So it's no longer $20 to buy back an ounce of gold. Is almost twice as much. You have to find $35 now to buy an ounce of gold. This is fraud. This is fraudulent. This is prohibited by Allah in the Quran 3 times. But our muftis probably didn't read that verse of the Quran when they declared this to be halal. Around the world, 1950s, 1960s, 1970s, 1980s, around the world you see the currencies of those countries which belong to the Jewish Christian Alliance, those currencies now are called hard currencies. And the rest are now called soft currencies. And these are falling in value, constant devaluation. And the IMF is at the back of it, supporting you to devalue and devalue to become more competitive. But as you devalue, there is a massive transfer of wealth from the unsuspecting masses to that global predatory elite, who not only want to become rich, that's bad enough, and have 3 Mercedes-Benz in your garage. No, they have their sights on something more than that. They not only want to rob you of your money, they want more than that. They want to impose their dictatorship over the whole world so that one man can rule the world from Jerusalem. This is where we are today. Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam said, the time will come when there will be nothing of value but a dinar and a dirham. This is his hadith. And see, we know that this entire fraudulent system is going to collapse. But it's not going to collapse now. It's only going to collapse after he's finished his job and he's ruling the world. And that's going to take another 40, 50 years. He said the only thing of value that will remain would be a dinar and a dirham. What's a dinar? A dinar is a gold coin. The word dinar is in the Quran. Yes. A dirham is a silver coin. The word dirham is in the Quran. Yes. And so there is going to be a tomorrow when even this new international monetary system of electronic money is going to collapse. And gold and silver is going to come back, are going to come back as money. We know that. Well, what do we do in the meantime? This is the most painful part of the lecture now. Because this is the part of the lecture where I am myself uncertain. What do we do now? You have to tell me what's going to happen. When this financial Armageddon takes place around the corner, it's coming. It would make 9/11 look like a footnote. When money around the world crashes, when people are wiped out, and if you have no money, you can't move, you're immobilized. That crash is coming. What do we do to prepare for it? There's going to be chaos. There's going to be bloodshed. There's going to be killing when that crash takes place and money is wiped out. What do we do? I have only one answer, and it is this. If this is a sunnah, this money which is with intrinsic value, gold and silver coins, and we have abandoned the sunnah, there's only one road to walk, and that is to recover the sunnah which has been abandoned. In order for us to recover the sunnah which is abandoned, we have to challenge the law which prohibits the use of gold and silver as legal tender. We have to ask very politely, why are you prohibiting the use of gold and silver as legal tender? In the process of challenging, mounting that legal challenge, we get an opportunity to teach and to educate the way that I'm doing here this morning. I hope and I pray that all of you become part and parcel of the effort that Nick Mahaney has been waging now for many years, to teach and to educate our people about money, to teach and educate our people about the fraudulent nature of the international monetary system that now exists, and the even more fraudulent one that's coming, and to teach and to explain to them the need to return to Sunnah money, the gold dinar, which is what is going to come in the future, inshallah. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا يا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين آمين. You want me there or here? Here, okay.
For question and answer session, you state your department and the bank you are currently attached to. Brother Imran, I now hand over the call to you.
Well, while you are apart, that surah is Suratul Kahfi of the Quran. I have written two books on Suratul Kahfi. The first one is a tafsir of the whole surah, but a modern tafsir, meaning a tafsir written in the modern age. It's a small book, it's at the back. We launched that book this Friday, last Friday, at Masjid Darul Islam Tamanta. So that book is not as yet in the bookshops. The second book is a bigger book, which is not tafsir but ta'wil, interpretation and analysis of the stories of Suratul Kahfi. That book explains to us the phenomenon of Dajjal and of Gog and Magog. a term that I did not use in my lecture today. Suratul Kahf in the modern age took me about 10 years to write. I started it 10 years ago in New York, and then I had to interrupt writing that book to write Jerusalem in the Quran. And then for 2 years I was traveling after 9/11. And then I came back home to Trinidad and I completed the book, and it was launched just Friday, last Friday. So that book is at the back, Suratul Kahfi and the Modern Age. And then I wrote a third book entitled Signs of the Last Day in the Modern Age, in which I use my knowledge of international politics, international economics, and the economics and the Quran to analyze current events unfolding in the world, like the feminist revolution, like the war on terror. And to show the links between these subjects and the signs of the last day. So that book also is at the back. It was launched just Friday, last Friday. It has not as yet reached the bookshops, but we have all three of those books at the back for you. Any questions from anybody? Excuse my coughing. No questions.
world, China, Islam, and the future of money. We close the session by reciting Tasbih Kafara and Surah to Ans.
I forgot to mention that while Bretton Woods had established a link between the US dollar and gold at $35 an ounce, and that any central bank could come to the United States with US dollars, and the United States was obliged under international law to redeem those dollars for gold. That lasted only until 1971. Nick Mahoney has just reminded me. In 1971, September 71, the British came. I think there was collusion between the British and the United States. The British came with about $3 billion and said, "Uncle Sam, are you there? Uncle Sam, I want to get the gold." $3 billion. So Richard Nixon retired to Camp David. They normally do that. And then on Sunday morning, he announced to the world that he was tearing up the Bretton Woods Agreement. He said, "We gave our word, but we don't have to keep it." And so since September 1971, there is no redeemability of the US dollar for gold. So no paper currency in the world has any integrity at all left in it after that. It's all fraudulent. Thank you very much.